everybody, and welcome to This Week in Figure Skating for the week of December 5th through 11th, 2011. The big eventful week, of course, but there were a couple events in here no one wanted. Most of all, the death of Kyoko Asada, mother to both Mao and Mai Asada, early Friday morning in Nagoya, after an apparently long battle with cirrhosis of the liver. She was 48. Poor Mao had flown to Quebec City for the Grand Prix finale, and when she heard her mother had turned critical Thursday, she hastily withdrew and jumped on a plane, but there was no way for her to get home in time. But both current coach Nobu Sato and former coach Machiko Yamada expressed their worry for her because she and her mother were very close. Says Yamada, "There was a particularly strong bond between them, and I am ever so worried for Mao. She's a tough character, but this will be very difficult for her to take." Both of the Asada sisters later made statements to their management companies in which they both thanked everyone, and Mao confirmed that for the last 6 months she's never been able to leave home without knowing her mother might not be there when she got back, and she initially hesitated about withdrawing but knew it was the right thing to do, and that she will honor her mother by working as hard as ever. Though the Canadian media had other priorities, as Reuters decided this week that it was a wonderful time to publish an interview they did with Patrick Chan 3 months ago just after he'd toured China, and where he'd made some rather dumb and ignorant comments about Chinese skatings and how things were in Canada by comparison, which they then twisted to make them sound even worse, resulting in a media firestorm where Chan had to do a lot of damage control, and Skate Canada even went so far as to demand an apology from the Globe and Mail. The Reuters reporter did later apologize. And so then, he took to the ice to answer there, hit his quadruple, and a split second later hit the boards, and he was addled enough to put a hand down on the triple axel. Though as it happened, no one skated clean in the short, and the only guy who could probably challenge him, Daisuke Takahashi, under-rotated his quad and over-rotated his lutz, which meant he didn't have the combo either, taking him 10 points back. While Michael Brezina turned out in the middle of his combo, went for the quad salco and fell, he did it with a hand down on the free, but mistakes there too, and ultimately finished last. Javier Fernandez also turned out in his combo and needed everything to finish it with only a double toe. Yuzuru Hanyu, who actually had been having trouble with the sprain ankle, fell out of his quad, and Jeremy Abbott got off with a turnout in the flip, at least once he tacked the triple toe onto the lutz instead, but he didn't have the quad. So Chan won the short, with Abbott and Fernandez following. Chan won the long, too, on his technical content, albeit barely, when he had another fall and some minor issues, mostly on those two quads, and Takahashi rebounded, rotating the steel two-footed quad and doing everything else perfect to rise up to silver, squeaking past Fernandez, who landed his two quads but lost little points on lots of jumps. The Spaniard secured bronze when Hanyu was third in the free by 0.2 but suffered a late program fall, and Abbott suffered too, though they at least both finally landed opening quads. With news of Kyoko Asada's death only reaching some of them mid-competition, the remaining five ladies went on. Though Alyssa Cisney injured her left calf during Thursday practice and it showed in both programs, she finished last and will be off the ice for a week. Young Elizaveta Tukmashieva struggled uncharacteristically in the short too, landing the triple X triple toe but then doubling her loop and then stepping out of her axle, which ultimately cost her a medal. Their second place free was close to clean, but only close. At the other end of the scale, Carolina Koster finally skated her short clean with a triple toe, and had a couple of problems in the long, but nothing worse than a singled axel. So even still without the let, she won, while behind her, Kiko Suzuki and Lena Leonova were left to battle for silver. The ambitious Suzuki went for the triple flip triple toe in the short, turned out of the flip and could only get a double toe, while Leonova more sensibly did a triple toe, though her jumps while clean were awkward, and she ended up a smidge behind Suzuki, with small errors and only one combo in the free, but she widened her lead when Leonova doubled the loop and fell on a lutz. She took silver and left the Russian with bronze. Aliona Sevchenko had this to say about those two competitions, "I see competitions for ladies and men, and we skate better." Before the competition began, Ingo Stoyer was interviewed too, in which Inga, the Russian pair that is now becoming their big rivals, might in fact be training under him now if Sevchenko and Solkovy had retired after the Olympics, though there was also the Russian Federation wanting them training in their own company, and he noted Sevchenko's being the leader of the two, and Solkovy being smart enough not to stand in her way. Though she did have a bad stumble out on the throw triple flip in the short, and they decided to sit the axle again, and they ended up a couple of points behind Tatiana Volosozhar and Maxim Trankov, who despite both recovering from injuries, him especially with his groin, skated clean, but he was not happy with the levels won on their twist and spin. He was right to be, because in the free, both teams skated clean, but the Russian jump landings were just a little less than smooth, and even that they could not afford when only 2 points up on Savchenko and Solkovy, and the latter lacked even those imperfections, and the Germans took gold, with the final difference being only 0.18. Of the other four teams, three had problems in both programs with their side-by-side jumps. The fourth, Don and Hao Zhang, were third after a flawless short, and their jumps were clean in the free, too. But their non-jump elements were weak, culminating in a bad lift at the end where it looked afterwards like he'd hurt his shoulder, and they dropped to fourth behind Yuka Kabaguchi and Alexander Smirnov as she doubled a toe in the short and singled the axel and stepped out of a throw in the free, but the rest of their programs were superior to the Chinese, and their jumps were Radford, who lost their long sequence to a fall, and especially Narumi Takahashi and Mervyn Traun, who had only one clean jumping pass in the entire competition. Both Ozhar and Trykov announced after the competition was over that their mutual injuries have caused them to make the decision to sit out of Russian nationals. Unfortunately, the long-anticipated battle between Meryl Davis and Charlie White and Tessa Virtue and Scott Moir was derailed when Moir took a fall in the short dance that might have addled him a little bit for the rest of the performance, ceding to Davis and White a 5-point lead that they were not going to relinquish. The Americans won the free dance too, if only by 0.05. But the Virtue and Moir, even if a couple of their lips weren't quite perfect with their own free dance, got straight level 4s, and Davis and White came one level 3 step sequence short of it. Moir wasn't happy with the lower presentation scores, though. Nathalie Pechel and Fabian Borza, through programs, got the more typical level 3 steps, level 4 everything else, and were excellent at everything except the free dance twizzles and one extended lift for bronze. Though they were tailed in both programs by Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poget, who performed so intensely she burst into tears afterwards, and they even beat the French technically in the free. Maya and Alexia Boutani, and especially Katerina Bobrova and Dimitri Solovyev weren't as good. The former do continue to improve, while the latter remain awkward on occasion. In the juniors, Jason Brown left his still unmastered triple axel on the practice ice, but did everything else great, including level 4 steps, to pull out a surprise win when a slightly ill Han Yan popped his axel in the short, even a quad, and a not quite clean but top scoring free only got him up to second, and Joshua Ferris's New York Mondoffer dropped into first to third with 2 falls. Julia Lipnitskaya got a standing ovation with her free and led the 2 Polinas in a Russian sweep, with the other 3 all having at least 1 bad program. Wenjing Sui and Kong Han went for both quad twist and quad throw. The former was fully downgraded and the latter two-footed, which was the least of their free issues, but they still won. While Canadians Catherine Boback and Ian Beharry and Americans Brittany Simpson and Matthew Blackmer played it safe to go 2-3 with more or less clean programs. And Victoria Sinzina and Ruslan Jiganshin led another Russian sweep, though Alexandra Stepanova and Ivan Bukin had to climb up to third after blowing the twizzes completely in the short. They ended up a point behind Anna Yanovskaya and Sergei Mozgov. The other senior international this week was the Golden Spin of Zagreb, in Croatia. Dennis Ten was there, attempting the quad in both programs and landing it in the free, but while he won the short, in the free he had 2 singled flips and dropped to second behind Tatsuki Mishida, who skated clean for gold. Behind them, even Beria followed up a clean short with an almost clean free, easily beating fellow Russian Artem Radulin for the bronze, even though the latter's only mistake in the free was popping an axel, though his short was very bad. Poor Adelina Sotnikova was actually first alternate for the Grand Prix finale, but by the time Mao pulled out, was way too late to get her to Canada, and she was competing here instead. And in the short, she actually landed her lutz, only to fall on her axel and see her triple toe fully downgraded, taking her a point under young Japanese skater Huna Suzuki. In the free, she landed a triple lutz triple loop and skated well for most of it, then fell on her last 2 jumps. But Suzuki had 2 singles and failed to complete her flip, so she dropped to second and left Sotnikova the winner by nearly 15 points. The rest of the field was much further behind. Russian Maria Tarasyeva took bronze, despite multiple mistakes in both programs, because the only other skater with her technical content in both programs, Slovenian Patricia Gleshik, skated a free a bit worse. Anastasia Martusheva and Alexei Roganov had a bigger field here than in their last international, but not much bigger with 6 teams, all of which they could beat easily, even with 2 falls in the short and issues on all 4 jumping passes in the free, too. And Germans Katharina Jarek and Florian Juice could similarly win silver with a fall and without any value on 2 of their elements in the free. At least once Israelis Daniel Montebello and Gaudi Krasbohulski had trouble in the short and also to fall as part of a mostly lost sequence and an invalidated death spiral in the free, but they still won bronze. Nor was victory too hard in the ice dance for Nelly Giganchi and Alex Gaji. The silver medalists Penny Coombs and Nicholas Buckland continue their rise, breaking 60 in the short and this time suffering no falls in the free, though their tariff was a bit low. Lower than Italian bronze medalist Charlene Guignard and Marco Fabri, though the latter had twizzle problems in the free. Sarah Hurtado and Adria Diaz were competing here too, but they didn't do that well, and there is now rumor that they are considering a coaching change. They are apparently going to someone in Canada. Most countries weren't holding their nationals through the week of the Grand Prix finale, but Australia did. There, Brendan Carey, just up from juniors, claimed his first senior national title by landing a triple lutz triple toe combo in the short, the hardest thing attempted in axelless competition, and being one of only 2 skaters to not suffer at least 1 fall in the free. Second and third, Nicholas Fernandez and Andrew Dodds both suffered 2. The ladies' competition was actually won by a pretty big margin by Ukrainian guest Irina Movchan, the only one to even partially rotate any triples, though even she made multiple mistakes in the free. The national title itself went to silver medalist Sarah Passfield, her first, despite her messing up all 3 of her jumping passes in the short and falling on her only double axel in the long, if only because her free was actually pretty clean otherwise, while everybody else's shorts and frees were very much not. There was no senior pairs competition, but there was a 2-team competition in the ice dance, but when Catherine Fierkin and Henry DuPont couldn't even stay on their feet in either program, Daniel O'Brien and Gregory Merriman claimed their 5th straight title with a total nearly twice that of the other team. In the juniors, Jordan Dobbs came up from second to win the men's, Chantel Carey won the ladies' competition, and with it the Youth Olympic Games berth. There was a two-team pairs competition, won by Vera Castilla and Callum Bullard, and a three-team ice dance competition, won by Matilda Friend and Patrick Adderley. Speaking of the Youth Games, Germany has nominated its entire team for all sports, including skating, which is Nico Lubanowski for men and much lower-ranked Charlotte Long and Daniel Linovich for dance. Also, following the silver medal at the Junior Grand Prix finale, Sergei Mozgov told the press he and Anevskaya will be competing in the dance, as has their coach. Still officially no announcement from the U.S. as I record this Monday morning, though their club has announced that Rachel and Michael Parson are among the selections. And for the next one, Lillehammer has won the second games in 2016, which wasn't actually much of a victory since they were the only ones that actually bid for it. With Russian nationals now fast approaching, Evgeny Plushenko is still being interviewed. There was a long one this week in which he gave his main reason for returning to competition. He was bored. To put it through Chrome threads, like, everything is so monotonous, moving from town to town, anything new, do not you grow up, I forget what the adrenaline, and I wanted it. So I started to play hockey, football, paintball, poke up golf, extreme driving, ride a motorcycle, still not that. That's when I took a decision to return. He denies claims that his shortest to Vanessa May, though most of the interview is really him repeating what we've heard already. He spoke very highly of Elvis Stoiko and his behavior towards him, though. Old Russian coaching legend Viktor Kudryavtsev has words, too, following last week's cup event after working with Xenia Makarova correcting her jump technique, though they aren't bothering with her lots yet. He has an interesting view of her prospects, Chrome translated, and I think that in order to compete in the battle for championship gold in Russia, Makarova will be sufficiently pure execution of those elements that it is now in the program. A second estimate, which plays a significant role in Xenia, is very high. This is an advantage to Makarova, even if she loses somewhere in the technical part, thanks to the second assessment, far more influential in the outcome of speech, it may outstrip rivals. He talks more generally about how Russian skating is implementing programs for teaching and testing basic skating skills, which they didn't have before, but now need. The 80s increase each week for Project Bolero. This week there were five, including one for Vera Arbuzova and Alexei Tikhonov, who for a while had been at the back of the rankings, though Kristina Kratova and Alexei Yagudin did it again. Tackling a difficult-to-perform-to song by a recently deceased Russian musical icon Ludmila Gurchenko, putting perfect technique to perfect expressive use while pouring so much emotion into it she was visibly shaken afterwards. Yagudin finished up another series of dramatic duets this week with a final engagement to Billy Averbuch's long-running City Lights, performed this week in Moscow after being delayed from November, and included Yagudin skating with Tatiana Navko, who also spent one number mostly dangling from the ceiling. Other participants in this final edition of the show included Albina Denkova and Maxim Stavisky sharing their tango burlesque, first with a chair, then with Oksana Domnina and Maxim Chabalin, as well as some live singing and dancing accompaniment on stage, and Johnny Weir skating as Charlie Chaplin. Speaking of the last, it looks like he really is engaged to Viktor, whom he described earlier this week in a CNN interview while participating in a panel discussion on equality, as a lawyer of Russian descent from Atlanta who only recently came out and didn't have an easy time of it, saying, "We're in a typical relationship that you would see on a sitcom, only we're two gay men." He's gotten to know Atlanta a bit better because of the relationship, too. Italian Nationals is next week, and new team Nicole Delamonico and Matteo Guarise gave an interview in anticipation, in which she revealed that while her official reason for retiring was physical injury, which is now healed, there was some mental burnout as well. They spoke a little about their music. The short is to Rhoda's Romeo and Juliet, and they say through Chrome Translate, "Unfortunately, we have not had much time to refine the program. We focus more on items than skated, but we hope to fix with the season progresses. On the free, no balance, we are still working, will most likely be something classic. They're working on pretty difficult jumps, including a throw flip, but add, again, Chrome Translated, we want to work on the quality of the item. We prefer to loop launched, a flip done well, rather than flaky." And from Guarise about Stephanie Aberton and Andrei Tokarczuk, "I'm a pacifist, I do not like to talk about fighting. Certainly two great athletes like Stephanie and Andrej, we can learn a lot. They'd like to get on the European and world teams, for which they'd need to go to a tiny event to get a qualifying score, probably the Challenge Cup or Bavarian Open. But their main goal is just to skate well and establish themselves this season." Guarise, in fact, skated with Caitlin Yankowskas 7 weeks, according to an update on her from the Detroit Free Press this week. She claims only that she wasn't willing to represent Italy, but words persist about the UFSSA not being willing to let her. She is settled in Detroit, but still doesn't have a partner, and is even preparing to take her senior freestyle test. If she can't find a partner next summer, she may try singles, but she says, "I'm definitely a pair girl. That will always be my first pick. I'm not finishing skating. I'm only 21. Look at Tatiana and Max. They didn't meet until they were like 26. It gives me hope." And that is This Week in Figure Skating. Good night.